This is my beloved 2012 Honda Civic. Like many older cars, it doesn't have Android Auto, as it predates its invention, so I'm stuck connecting my phone over Bluetooth to the stereo, which works well, but I'm stuck with having my phone in this little holder here, which can be cumbersome if I need to change my navigation directions, play a song on Spotify, or if I get a phone call and I have to switch my apps. So this is very dangerous and also kind of sucks when I have to open the door as the phone gets stuck. So I thought to myself, well, what can I do about it? Now usually, the fix is swapping out the stereo for an aftermarket head unit. But those are bulky, expensive, and don't really integrate well with the Civic's existing IMID display and steering wheel controls. Since I love the integration and clean look of this dash, I wanted something better. Then I had an idea. What if I could send Android Auto's video feed directly into this little IMID screen and control it with a knob, just like BMW's iDrive system? And while we're at it, why not just fix another glaring issue with the car? It doesn't have a backup camera. Parallel parking in tight spots shouldn't be done by Braille. Before I show you how I made this all work, let me show it to you in action. First, you need to make sure the system's even enabled. This switch will enable it. Flip to the on position. The system only turns on when you turn the key. You'll see it'll boot up here in a sec. This is using the video signal from the backup camera, and it switches off with the backup camera at any time. So you can see when I put the car in reverse, it'll switch over to the backup view. The backup view is pretty bad and I need to change the camera angle, but that's a problem for another day. So now we can see we're in the main menu of Crankshaft. This allows me to change all the settings. Now we can plug in our phone. We could have actually had our phone plugged in the entire time, but I didn't plug it in yet so we could see the menu. So here, let's plug it in. We'll see, Android Auto should start. Now that Android Auto has started, let's go over how it's controlled. Down here we can see the controller. This was inspired by Mazda and BMW's Android Auto controllers. You'll see it has a knob for selecting options, this directional pad for selecting screens and other menus, and each of these buttons perform a function, which I'll go over. This entire thing acts as a kind of USB keyboard and mouse and plugs into the Android Auto system, which is underneath this plastic piece here next to the airbag computer. It all plugs in here. You can see this is where the controller plugs in. There's a little USB port I put here, so I can plug in other peripherals such as keyboard and mice if I need to edit the configuration. The USB from the phone just follows the same path and goes behind the plastic cladding. Let's go over some of the functions. I'm not sure if you'll be able to see, but here turning the knob lets you select different menus on the screen. Say, for instance, we want to select the phone menu. That'll bring it up. And so this is where the directional pad comes into play, because I can't select the bottom taskbar. I'll just keep scrolling. But when I press down, I can select the bottom menu here again. And I can open, let's say, the news. If I want to play or pause at any time, I can just press down the directional stick, and that'll toggle the play pause. Say now I want to get back to the maps quickly. This button right here just opens your navigation. Say I want to split screen this. The bottom right corner here, you can see there's a split screen button usually. So this button just controls. So this button controls that. And if you press it again, it'll bring you to the home screen. Press it again, you're back to the split screen. This works since this device emulates a mouse and just clicks in the bottom right corner there. Let's say you open a menu in maybe Google Maps and you want to close it. How can you do that? This button here is the back button. It just gets you out of the menu. This button right here brings you to the home screen, so you can select whichever app you'd like. Say you need to make a phone call quickly. This button right here opens the phone app. Let's go back to split screen. There you go. That's how everything works. And so here I can press left and select Spotify, I can skip the track. Excuse me, not Spotify, the news. You can see here, we can even see our notifications. Everything works. And whenever we need to, we can switch into reverse. And it switches the camera back and forth. And this little device here just simply comes out and goes back into the cup holder. Now let's move on to how this was accomplished. First things first, I needed a way to feed the video into the IMID screen. After some research, I found out that you can just buy a wiring harness that enables video input, usually intended for backup cameras. That was huge. It meant I could send both a backup camera feed and Android Auto to the display over composite video. So I installed the backup camera, but it's terribly angled because the eBay listing lied a little bit about compatibility. Classic. Then, I pulled apart the dashboard and installed the new wiring harness. The IMID display knows when to switch to the video signal when the wire gets 12 volts, typically from the reverse lights. This is great since we can easily send a 12-volt signal when we need Android Auto to be displayed as well. Time to move on to the exciting stuff, actually running Android Auto. I started out by researching my options for running Android Auto on my own hardware, namely my Raspberry Pi 3B. I found out that there are two great options for running Android Auto on the Pi, Crankshaft and OpenDash. OpenDash is the more active of the two and supports tons of features like writing your own plugins, OBD, and CAN bus integration, as well as running on top of a fully fledged Raspberry Pi operating system. On the other hand, Crankshaft is more inactive and doesn't allow for the level of customization as OpenDash does, but what it does allow is routing the audio stream through the phone's Bluetooth connection to the car, rather than routing it through the Raspberry Pi. This one difference was the deciding factor for me as I wanted to retain steering wheel control functionality, which is easily done if the phone connects to the car for audio playback. After flashing Crankshaft to an SD card and booting it up, I had some initial challenges. I found that I had to change the OpenAuto mode to X11 and change the config.txt and commandline.txt files to allow for composite video out, as the car does not accept an HDMI signal. Now it's time to figure out how to control the Android Auto interface without a touchscreen. Inspired by BMW's iDrive system, I wanted to have a rotating knob to select elements on the screen, and some shortcut buttons. Since my car wasn't intended for this system, I decided I would just plop my device down in the front cup holder that I don't use anyways, since it interferes with the shifter. Since Crankshaft allows for keyboard and mouse integration, I used an inexpensive Arduino Pro Micro to emulate a keyboard and mouse. I'm using a rotary encoder, as well as a directional pad, and some mechanical keyboard switches for my buttons. I decided on this layout as it allows for ergonomic operation while the device is in the cup holder. And since I'll be using this in the car, I decided to print this out of PETG rather than PLA for the better thermal resistance due to the higher glass transition temperature. Next, I got to designing an enclosure for my little Raspberry Pi guy. Since it'll be tucked away in the car somewhere, and it does get hot here in the summer, I thought it would be necessary to have a proper cooling solution, so I'm using a microcenter heatsink as well as a fan from a broken Wii U console. To power this whole ordeal, I was hoping to use a tiny linear voltage regulator that would convert the 12 volts from the car to 5 volts for the Raspberry Pi, but unfortunately the regulator I had on hand could only handle 3 amps, which is not enough as the internet alleges the Pi itself needs 2.5 amps. And since I would be charging my phone with this power source, I figured I should use a beefier converter. And in this case, I used an adjustable buck converter I had lying around, which can supposedly handle 9 amps of current. Now that I had that sorted out, I decided to build a little box to house the Raspberry Pi, the fan, and the buck converter to keep my installation neat. Happy with my progress, it was time to move on to figuring out how to connect all of this together. I found that fuse slot 36 would supply power when the key is turned on, but not off, and installed a fused circuit adder. This 12-volt line would run to a power switch and then to my buck converter, and then to the Raspberry Pi setup, as well as the new wiring harness to signal that the video needs to be displayed. This leads to a problem. If you have the reverse lights and the 12-volt power supply from the Raspberry Pi feeding into the same signal line for the IMID display, they will power each other inadvertently. So to remedy this, I simply put in two diodes to make sure that there would be no backfeeding. Now that we would constantly see the Android Auto video feed when it was powered on, I needed to figure out how to switch to the backup camera temporarily when in reverse. For this, I'm simply using a regular relay, which when it receives the reverse light signal from the taillights, it disconnects the video feed from the Android Auto display. Both Android Auto and the backup cam are fed into the same composite cable after this relay, so this works nicely. Now that the video and positive power wiring were taken care of, grounding was next. The screw attaching the fuse box to the chassis is a great ground connection, so I soldered a ground cable to the washer and connected that to the buck converter. I also soldered a USB extension to the Pi for peripherals in the cabin and connected the USB-C cable for my phone. At this point, I screwed everything together and did some cable management, then closed up my dashboard and crossed my fingers and toes that it would work. And it did work. Well, mostly. Initially, there was a backup camera overlay on the screen, but after digging through some diagnostic menus, I was able to reposition it to the bottom of the screen, out of the way of the video. With that, everything was working smoothly now. Now I just had to figure out which buttons to assign to which shortcuts. Thanks for watching. If you'd like a tutorial that goes into depth on how to do this, let me know in the comments.